Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dreamers by Angela Hunt, narrated by Stina Nielsen. Prologue. Dothan. The collision of bones and rock stopped his fall. He did not immediately lose consciousness, but gasped in the depths of the narrow cistern, his limbs and tongue and vision paralyzed by shock and a wave of unspeakable horror. Murder had gleamed in their eyes. Did they truly hate him so much? Pinpricks of pain ripped along every nerve of his body, and after a moment of senseless suppression, Joseph released the scream clawing in his throat. The sound echoed through the rock-walled cistern and grew into a chorus of agonized cries. From somewhere above him, his brothers heard and laughed. Familiar voices, crackling sharply in hostility, came spiraling down from the mouth of the cavern.
Hear that? The dreamer is not hurt badly enough. We should have found a deeper pit.
The brat isn't so high and mighty now. Yet just last month he had visions of authority and power.
They were but the dreams of a 17-year-old. For all youths think themselves invincible and immortal. Even you, Dan, were of such a mind when you were his age.
Dan never had the gall to predict that even our father would bow down to him, yet our father scrapes before the boy already. He gives Joseph everything.
We should kill him, I tell you. If he survives, this talebearer will run to our father. He'll take even our birthrights, for he is the pampered favorite.
Yehuda is right. Our father sides with the would-be king in every argument.
Have you noticed how the old man smiles at him? My stomach churns when I think of it.
My own son is older, stronger, and better favored, and yet I despise his pride. As do you.
Reuven's voice quieted the others and echoed in the pit. Listening below, the boy bit his lip in an effort to quiet his involuntary moaning, as Reuven continued.
I, too, have reason to hate him. I should receive the firstborn's inheritance. But I know our father will honor this stripling with the largest share of his goods. But we are of the same flesh. I cannot kill him, and neither can you.
Then we will have someone else do it.
Dan's voice brimmed with eagerness.
If you are hesitant, Reuven, I will hire someone to spill his precious blood over this cursed coat. We will say a lion caught him,
Levi interrupted.
Our father will believe it, and we will forever be rid of the troublemaker.
Reuven's stentorian voice hushed the others. Would you have our father die of grief? We will not kill him. We shall leave him here and let him ponder his own fate. Let him who aspires to rise a king pass the night in the depths of the earth.
The brothers mumbled and murmured, but most of them moved away.
I'd still like to spill his guts,
Asher grumbled, his voice overriding the fading voices.
Look at him whimpering there. If he rises from this pit, our father will never forgive us for his injuries.
But if we cut out his tongue, he will never boast again.
We'll shed no blood before dinner,
Reuven answered.
Come, Asher. Our meal is waiting.
Joseph remained still until he was certain the last of his brothers had gone. Then he struggled to focus his blurred vision on the walls around him. Reuven would not let them kill him. Reuven was respected. He would be obeyed. But for how long? Murderous intent might bring any of the brothers back during the night with a dagger thirsting for blood. He had to escape. He pulled his heavy head from the rock and steeled himself to ignore the white-hot pain that shot along his limbs as he fumbled against the stone beneath him. His left arm would not cooperate, and when he glanced down at his side, he saw why. Above his elbow, where there had once been smooth skin and healthy muscle, a white shard of jagged bone protruded from an oozing red wound. A hoarse cry escaped his lips as unconsciousness claimed him. Chapter 1. Thebes, Egypt. A high-pitched giggle broke the stillness of the garden. From between the branches of the bush where she hid, Tuya saw her mistress pause in mid-step on the path.
"Tuya, I command you to speak," Sagira called, peering around the slender trunk of an acacia tree. "You must make more noise, or how am I to find you?"
Tuya deliberately rustled the ivy on the wall behind her, but the noise was slight, and Sagira did not turn toward the sound. Finally, Tuya took a deep breath and spoke.
"Life, prosperity, and health to you, my lady." "Aha!"
Sagira turned and sprinted toward Tuya's hiding place as the slave girl darted from the bush.
"I found you, but you haven't caught me,"
Tuya cried, arching away from Sagira's grasping hands. The two girls ran laughing through the garden until Sagira tripped over a rock at the edge of the pond. Pinwheeling, she struggled to keep her balance, then surrendered to the pull of the earth and fell with a splash into the shallow water. Tuya's heart leapt into her throat, but after a moment, Sagira sat up and howled with a 12-year-old's unrestrained glee. Tuya laughed too, then stopped. The Lady Kahent might be watching. Would she have Tuya whipped for this mishap? She glanced toward the house.
"I am sorry, mistress. Truly I am."
Sagira pulled dark ribbons of wet hair from her face and stood in the knee-deep water, then took a deep, happy breath.
"It wasn't your fault, Tuya,"
she said, moving to the edge of the pool. Her thin linen sheath clung to her wet body and accented her budding figure. A trace of mud lay across her delicate face, and her dark eyes sparkled with mischief.
"Would you like me to pull you in? The water is wonderfully cool."
"No, my lady." Tuya looked toward the house again. "I should not like to muss my dress. Your mother would not approve."
"Then I command you to keep still."
The floating lotus plants jostled each other as Sagira climbed out of the pool.
"Our little game is not done."
Tuya stood as still as a post, her arms hanging rigid until her mistress dripped in front of her.
"There."
Sagira clapped wet hands on the slave's bare shoulders.
"I caught you. I win again."
"Yes, my lady."
"I must win."
Sagira grinned wickedly as she flung water from her hands into Tuya's face.
"It is only fitting that Pharaoh's niece should win in everything she undertakes."
Tuya said nothing, but smiled as Sagira pirouetted in front of the long reflecting pool. She paused and studied her watery image.
"Do you think me beautiful, Tuya?"
Tuya lowered her gaze as she pondered her answer. Should she speak as a friend and tease Sagira about the small gap between her front teeth? Or should she reply as a dutiful servant and assure her mistress that no girl in the two kingdoms could rival her beauty and charm? Not an easy decision, for Tuya had lately been reminded of the solid line between friendship and servanthood. She had been only 6 years old when presented as a gift for Sagira's third birthday, and as children they had shared everything. But though she often felt like Sagira's older sister, when her mistress's red moon had begun to flow, Sagira's mother, the Lady Kahent, had urged her daughter to put aside her baby name and assume a mantle of dignity. Her new name, Sagira, or Little One, referred to her petite frame. Tuya had never been called anything but Tuya, for slaves were not permitted the luxury of adult names, and of late, Sagira's mother had been quick to emphasize the gulf existing between masters and their slaves. Certain attitudes and actions were proper, while others were not. Twice, Tuya had been whipped for overstepping the bounds of propriety, but Sagira seemed not to have noticed the newfound care with which Tuya formulated her answers, attitudes, and comments. Diplomacy won out.
You are beautiful, mistress, Tuya whispered, lowering her head in an attitude of deference. Lucky is the man who will be your husband.
And you, Tuya? Do you ever dream of marriage?
Sagira cocked her head and gave her slave an engaging smile.
Do you ever wonder what it is like to kiss a man? To sleep with him as my mother sleeps with my father?
Tuya felt her cheeks burning. I dare not think of those things, she said, stealing a quick glance toward the wide doors that opened into the courtyard. I am your servant. I will go where you go and serve you always.
Tuya!
Sagira's voice rang with reproach, for she had seen her servant's frightened glance. She took Tuya's hand and pulled her into the privacy of an arbor.
You can speak freely now, she said, a slow smile crossing her face. You need not fear my mother.
I don't...
Don't pretend with me, Tuya. I know about the whippings. Even though you acted as though nothing had happened, I saw the mark of the lash on your shoulders and asked Tanutamon about them. He said my mother ordered both whippings.
I am sure I deserved them. Tuya's stomach tightened as her ears strained for sounds of eavesdroppers beyond the trees. Would even this conversation be reported to Lady Kahent? Sagira's eyes lit with understanding.
You did not deserve it. The first time was because you were wearing my jewels, but you did not tell my mother I asked you to model them for me. And the second time was because we were laughing together.
I was too familiar. A slave should not be on such close terms.
You are my friend, Tuya. We have laughed and cried together since I was a baby. Can we stop being friends now?
Tuya smiled in a fleeting moment of hope. Sagira seemed earnest, and her mother could not see into the thickly green arbor. Perhaps she could safely open her heart. I do not know how to behave anymore, she confessed, lifting her gaze. Your mother says, now that you are grown, I must be your servant, not your friend. She said, although you may confide in me, I must not speak what is on my heart, for no one cares what a slave thinks. Sagira flushed to the roots of her hair.
She did not say such a thing.
Tuya pressed her lips together and kept silent.
My mother is the best mistress any slave could have,
Sagira said, turning on Tuya with a flash of defensive spirit. She crossed her arms and sat on a low bench in the arbor.
Our slaves have greater freedom than any house I've seen. My father is as rich in graciousness as he is in gold.
Tuya slowly lowered herself to the bench.
You are right, my lady.
Sagira sniffed.
Well then, you do not need to worry about anything. And I have a surprise for you. When I am married, I shall take you out of this house and give you your freedom. Then you can marry as well, and we shall live next to each other and talk every day as we do now.
Hope rose from Tuya's heart like a startled bird.
You would do that?
Truly, Sagira's eyes glowed. And then you shall tell me all about your husband, just as you told me about what to expect with the flowering of my red moon. And when you have a baby,
Sagira looked down and twisted her hands,
you shall tell me if it is truly as terrible as it seems.
It cannot be too terrible.
Tuya softened her voice, realizing that Sagira now spoke out of fear. I am sure that bearing the child of a man you love must be a great joy. And the priests say that offerings to the goddess Tauret will keep evil away from a woman giving birth. The two girls sat in silence, pondering the mysterious rites they were just beginning to understand. Overhead, a hawk scrolled the hot updrafts, precise and unconcerned, a part of the sky. Tuya envied his freedom.
Do you ever think about love, Tuya?
Sagira said, running her hands through her wet hair. Love? How and when it begins? My mother says love comes after marriage, but I have heard scandalous things from some of the other servants. They say one of the serving girls fell in love with one of the shepherds. For the love of this shepherd, she openly defied Tanutamon. He sold her that very morning for her rebellion.
I am sure, Tuya said, a creeping uneasiness rising from the bottom of her heart, that the captain of your father's slaves acted wisely. Rebellion cannot be tolerated.
Sagira tilted her head and gave Tuya a searching look.
You wouldn't do that, would you?
Fall in love with some man and leave me?
I don't think love is meant for one like me,
Tuya answered slowly.
I love you, mistress. I want to follow wherever you go. I have not left your side in 9 years, so I am not likely to leave it now.
Nor would I have you leave it,
Sagira answered, now serious. She reached out and clasped Tuya's hands.
By all the gods, Tuya, my heart goes into shock when I think of marrying and leaving my father's house. Only because I know you will be with me can I think about going at all.
Tuya's heart warmed at the light of dependence in her young mistress's eyes. There is no need to worry. Your mother and father are in no hurry to find a husband for you. You are no commoner, Sagira. Pharaoh himself must be consulted. Sagira sighed. Then her mocking smile returned.
Then we will marry at the same time, and you will be my friend always.
She planted a brief kiss on Tuya's cheek, then dropped Tuya's hands and stood to stretch.
Ugh, this wet dress grows cold. Come, find me a dry garment and bind my hair. We will play the hiding game in my chamber until my mother tells us it is time to eat.
Tuya smiled and hurried to match her mistress's eager step. The girls' happy voices danced ahead of them into the house. Reclining on a pillow-laden couch in the villa's reception room, Kahent heard the sound.
Our daughter is growing up,
she whispered, her dark, liquid voice intended for her husband's ears alone. Intent on studying the scrolls on his lap, Doncor grunted.
It is time, I believe,
Kahent persisted,
to approach Pharaoh about finding Sagira a husband. Surely the king knows his sister has a daughter of noble blood.
Doncor finally looked up.
Pharaoh knows what?
Kahent sighed, careful not to let her frustration show.
Our king knows we have a daughter. Now he must be told that she has reached marriageable age. Her red moon has flowed twice now.
She is too young.
Doncor waved his hand carelessly and returned his attention to his scrolls, but Kahent would not be deterred. She had borne his indifference for years. If he had been more attentive, or she more beautiful, they might have had more than one child, but Doncor cared more for his treasures than for the people who lived in his house. After resigning herself to her husband's cold heart, Kahent had invested her love and life in her daughter. She stood and leaned against one of the columns in the room, steeling herself for a confrontation.
Sagira is young,
she said, not daring to contradict him.
So we have time to find the best man for her.
She lifted her chin so the beads in the heavy wig she wore clicked together as they fell against her smooth shoulders.
This endeavor will not require your effort, my husband. Only your permission. Grant me your blessing to speak to my brother about our daughter. Your honor demands that I do this.
Doncor's brow furrowed as he looked up from his scroll and Kahent knew he had only half heard her words.
Pharaoh will see to the girl's marriage when I publish the news of her maturity.
We must proceed slowly, Kahent said, with a cautionary lift of a manicured finger. We should find a suitable man before we reveal our intentions. Then we may drop the suggestion on Pharaoh's ear. Our daughter's husband must be close to Pharaoh, for the line of kings flows through my veins and Sagira's.
If something should happen to Pharaoh, or to his sons...
She finished with an expressive shrug. Doncor gave her a smile of reluctant admiration.
I have seen eyes like yours in the faces of my enemies.
He lifted his scroll again.
I would not like to have your determination set against me.
Why should you? She asked, glad that he had looked at her with the light of amusement in his eyes.
There is one other thing. I must be rid of the servant girl, Tuya.
The scroll dropped again.
But Sagira would be lost without her. It is impossible to imagine one without the other.
Have you looked at Tuya lately, my husband?
Kahent found it impossible to keep an edge from her voice. The slave has become quite attractive. If Tuya follows our daughter into her marital home, the slave will capture the groom's attention.
Doncor scoffed. Our daughter is lovely. I cannot believe that you, her mother, would belittle her.
I do not dispute Sagira's loveliness.
Kahent sank onto a gilded settee and reached for one of the figs piled atop a golden platter on a nearby stand.
But I want to give our daughter every possible advantage. Sagira is attractive. But a woman must believe herself beautiful to become so. I fear Sagira will compare herself to Tuya, whom the gods have unfairly blessed.
So how do you intend to separate the girls?
Doncor's voice had flattened, and Kahent knew she had already lost his attention to the papyrus scroll in his lap.
I will make an offering to the goddess Bastet, she murmured, bringing the fig to her lips. She will show me the way.
Chapter 2. The glare of the desert sun blinded Potiphar for a moment. He raised his hand to shade his eyes and nodded in silent satisfaction as warriors laid bodies before him. 26 rebels dead, their blood staining the sand. 33 others now in the bonds of defeat. He would present the slaves to his royal master, Pharaoh Amenhotep II, and further prove that he had earned the name Potiphar, captain of the guard, the appointed one of Pharaoh. He signaled for his men to leave the dead as a warning to any others who might invade Pharaoh's peaceful delta.
Let their mongrel bodies be consumed by worms and rats. Their immortal souls did not deserve to travel through the afterlife.
Potiphar!
The cry from a warrior on a cliff above them wrested his eyes from the dead.
Horus, the falcon god, salutes you!
The warrior lifted his hand to the sky, where a hawk circled lazily above the blood-soaked sands. Potiphar smiled in reply.
So be it.
He turned from the grisly scene and murmured under his breath as he strode toward his waiting chariot.
But it is not Horus's approval I seek.
He had entered royal service during the latter part of the reign of Thutmose III, the pharaoh whose first battle had been to unseat his stepmother from the throne of the upper and lower kingdoms. A common man with an uncommon love for battle, Potiphar joined the king's army for the campaign that culminated at the fortress of Megiddo Armageddon. Overflowing with youthful enthusiasm, drive, and shrewd intuitions, Potiphar discovered that the prospect of war affected him like a fever. In a moment of reckless abandon, he approached the king's generals
and suggested that the Egyptian army cross Mount Carmel to surprise the enemy from behind. Tutmosis appreciated the subtlety of the strategy. The Asiatics expected the Egyptians to approach in a direct attack from the southern plains, so when the Egyptian cavalry appeared on the northern horizon, the panicked enemy fled to their fortress, leaving Potiphar to maintain the siege of the stronghold. Tutmosis raided the lands of neighboring kings and chieftains, then returned to the starving fortress to claim his victory. Pharaoh completed his conquest by harvesting the crops of the land. The Asiatics, who had to eat, bowed before the Egyptian king in submission. The king's victory at Megiddo secured Potiphar's place in the royal retinue. Under Tutmosis III, Potiphar led armies that conquered lands from the Fifth Cataract of the Nile to the Euphrates River. Tutmosis, like Potiphar, relished the thrill of war. His standing army included hundreds of ferocious Nubian warriors whose ancestors had won battles for previous pharaohs. Iron-willed and hard as stone, Potiphar thought himself invincible, until he was taken prisoner on one expedition with the Nubians. After his capture, he spat in his captors' faces, fully expecting to die. The king of Kadesh, a wily and able adversary, wielded his sword and extracted from Potiphar what many would have considered to be the ultimate sacrifice a man could make for his king. But after days of blinding white pain, Potiphar did not die. A contingent of Egyptian troops stormed the enemy's camp and rescued their general, bringing the wounded Potiphar back to stand before Tutmosis. The fading warrior king in the 55th year of his reign proclaimed before his entire court that Potiphar was a friend of Pharaoh and would henceforth serve as captain of the king's bodyguard. Potiphar was awarded a villa, a staff of slaves, and a secure position, but before his body could heal, the great king died. From his bed of convalescence, Potiphar watched with trepidation as the crown prince assumed the throne. 20-year-old Amenhotep II loved the sea and had spent most of his princely preparation at the Egyptian naval base at Per Nefer near Memphis. Potiphar wondered how the new king would feel about joining his father's court at Thebes. But join it he must. The pharaoh of Egypt could not afford to appear weak or indecisive. With the mighty Tutmosis III dead, the Asiatic city-states and their allies would undoubtedly attempt to throw off the Egyptian yoke. They would put the young new king's military prowess to the test. In the following months, neither Potiphar nor the far-flung city-states found the new king lacking. Excelling in battle, archery, and horsemanship, Amenhotep delighted in hand-to-hand combat. With Potiphar at his side, he led his troops into battle, howling in royal rage. Often the mere sight of his ferocious visage convinced dismayed enemy troops to surrender. Now, in the 13th year of his reign, Amenhotep had accomplished his military goals. The far-flung provinces dutifully sent tribute to their king and toiled to keep peace in the land. Military maneuvers now involved only infrequent skirmishes from rebellious territories, and Potiphar rarely rode with the army. He found it difficult to admit, but at 44, he had grown tired of the wind in his face and sand in his teeth. But he continued to venture onto the battlefield in the hope that a spectacular victory would bring him the one prize he lacked, the gold of praise to encircle his neck. The gold of praise, the most obvious and visible symbol of Pharaoh's favor, was a solid gold chain awarded to the man who had proved himself a friend of Pharaoh. Though Tutmosis had proclaimed Potiphar his friend, that noble king had died before presenting his wounded general with the gold of praise. Potiphar had earned it. If the gods were just, at some point in this life, he would yet wear it around his neck. Chapter 3. A bitter wind howled around the caravan, and Joseph found himself wincing with every step across the desert sand. A stout rope bound his wrists, while the end of the rope connected him to the saddle of a sour-faced camel belonging to a caravan of Yishmaelites from Gilead. With each step of the Yishmaelite's beast, the rope tightened and tugged on Joseph's broken arm. Every step, every breath brought exquisite pain. He had fainted when they first wrenched his arm to tie him with the other prisoners bound for Egypt. One of the traders tossed a bucketful of foul water in his face to wake him. Now, Joseph stumbled through the desert in a stupor of agony and grief. In lucid moments, he wondered why his life had taken such a vicious and unpredictable turn. His father, the one constant loving figure in his life since his mother's death, would feel this loss even more keenly than the grief of losing his beloved Rahel.
"At least I have you,"
his father had often said, his gnarled hand patting Yosef's as they walked together.
"As long as I have you, Rahel lives on in your eyes."
How could his brothers do this to their father? To him? Why did they hate him so? Nothing in his past warranted such treatment. A loving and obedient son to his father, he had been the favored firstborn of Yaakov's favorite wife, Rahel. His brothers were less than doting, probably because they were envious of the close relationship he shared with their father. When Rahel died giving birth to Binyamin, Yaakov pulled Yosef aside and spilled his heart, opening a window through which Yosef glimpsed a love as strong as God and a grief as deep as death. For the first time, Yaakov recited his personal history, explaining to Yosef how each of his brothers came to be born. Compassion conceived the sons of Leah. Duty resulted in the sons of Bilhah. Guilt fathered the sons of Zilpah. Only with Rahel, Yaakov told Yosef, were sons given life in love. Perhaps this knowledge gave birth to his dreams. One night, not long after his mother's death, Yosef had dreamed that he and his brothers were binding sheaves of grain. Suddenly, Yosef's sheaf jerked itself out of his hands as if it possessed a life of its own. Dancing away from the rope with which he would have tied it, the tall sheaf moved to the center of the cleared field and stood upright. Within minutes, the sheaves of his brothers were similarly animated, but those sheaves circled Yosef's, then prostrated themselves on the ground before the golden sheaf in the center of the circle. His brothers had not found the dream at all entertaining.
"Do you intend to reign over us?"
Yehuda sneered when Yosef told them of the strange vision.
"Will you actually rule us?"
Only Reuven's diplomatic intervention prevented a fist fight. The next night, Yosef had a similar dream. In this dream, he sat on a star while the sun and moon and 11 other stars drew near and bowed to him. When he described the dream the next morning, even his father laughed.
"What is this?"
Yaakov said, his face darkening to a deep shade of red as he sat before the breakfast fire.
"Will your departed mother and I join your brothers and actually bow before you? Surely you think too much of yourself, Yosef, and of these dreams. Forget them, my son, and remember that when pride comes, disgrace follows."
His father's words proved strangely prophetic. Joseph had taken quiet pleasure in those dreams while he dwelled securely in his father's favor. But now, in the harsh light of reality and the bitterness of pain, those mocking fantasies seemed as false as vows made in wine. He had dared to dream that God would honor him as primary inheritor of the blessings and promises of Abraham. But those hopes, too, were surely foolish. Disgrace and despair walked with him across the desert. From the chatter of the Ishmaelites, Joseph knew he was on his way to the Black Land, Egypt. He had heard much of the place, for his great-grandfather, Abraham, had found trouble among its people. Plagued by fear and blessed with a beautiful wife, Abraham lied to the Egyptians and told them that Sarai was his sister, not his wife. Unaware that he desired another man's wife, Pharaoh took Sarai into the royal harem and suffered the plagues of God for his sin. When the truth was revealed, Pharaoh asked Abraham to take his wife, his livestock, all that he had, and leave the country. The king's army had escorted Abraham from the land to ensure that nothing remained behind. Now, Abraham's great-grandson was returning to Egypt as a bloody and broken slave, reeking of camels and filth. Was this God's divine punishment for Abraham's sin? Were the Egyptians now to have their vengeance on one of his descendants? Despite the pain, Joseph lifted his head in pride as the rope bit into his wrists and pulled him forward. Whatever happened, he would not repeat Abraham's sin. He would not lie. But to preserve his life, neither would he admit to anyone that he was of the house and lineage of the one they had known as Avram. Chapter 4. Kahent woke before the sun's rising and dressed in her finest garment, a narrow sheath of white linen that fell in intricate pleats from her shoulders to the floor. She selected her favorite beaded necklaces, bracelets, and belt, then sat at her table to paint her face. Dipping an exquisitely carved copper applicator into the container for her kohl, she outlined her eyes and dabbed her fingers into a secret compartment inside a carved ivory duck on her dressing table. With a deft movement, she swiped a mixture of ground malachite and animal fat across her eyelids, effectively giving them a golden green glow. Green, she reflected, was the color of fertility, the root and purpose of the petition she would bring today. When her face had been properly painted, Kahent's maid lifted her heavy wig from its stand and placed it on her mistress's head. Like all Egyptian noblewomen, Kahent wore her hair clipped short, a necessity when no woman of standing went out in public without her wig. The massive wig was as wide as Kahent's shoulders and several layers thick. A lush fringe of bangs accented the dark lines around her eyes, and the beads that had been woven into the ends of the woolen strands clicked together with a pleasing sound. Kahent slipped her feet into her papyrus sandals, then lifted a bag of silver from her husband's treasure chest. Offerings of fruit and meat would not be enough for today. She planned on asking the goddess Bastet for a serious boon, and a noteworthy offering would certainly be required. Her maids stood back, and Kahent pointed wordlessly to the one who would accompany her to the temple. The other blinked, probably in relief, and the chosen slave lifted the earthen lamp from its stand and moved toward the outer courtyard, where a special bundle waited. Kahent had chosen the goddess Bastet as her patron god, and since cats were sacred to that goddess, more than 30 cats lived within the walls of this household. When they died, Kahent paid handsomely to have the animals mummified and wrapped in linen. A storeroom near the temple of the house was stocked with cat-shaped coffins in which the mummified cats rested in their eternal journey. The sleepy servant lifted one of the papyrus coffins into her arms and laid it across her mistress's open palms. Reverently, Kahent carried the burden through the gate and led the way through the streets of Thebes to the temple dedicated to the goddess Bastet. After entering the rectangular enclosure surrounding the temple, Kahent left her maid in the outer courtyard and carried the small coffin into Perhare, the House of Rejoicing. In front of its towers stood twin statues, two cats carved of green marble. Dark crevices loomed where the eyes should have been, and golden rings hung from the nostrils. A silver pectoral with the sacred eye of Horus decorated the chests of both animals, signifying that Horus himself protected the cat from evil. Kahent always felt a sudden chill whenever she saw an amulet depicting the Wedjet eye. According to the legends of the gods, Seth, a god of evil, tore out the eye of Horus in a struggle for the throne of Egypt. Once in a temple play, Donkor forced her to attend. An actor portraying Seth had actually plucked the eye from an unfortunate prisoner. After the bloodletting, Kahent had left her husband's side and fled the theater, knowing full well that the ancient legend would require that the prisoner also be dismembered before the play's end. No bloody legends were associated with Bastet. She was the daughter of Re, the sun god, and represented the benign power of the sun to ripen crops. After kneeling before the two regal statues, Kahent proceeded to the sacred burial grounds and placed the cat coffin in an empty space. She bowed her head to the earth and murmured words of allegiance, then walked slowly back to the Perhare and passed through the entryway. The morning sun had begun to beat on the earth in relentless waves of energy, but cool air filled the House of Rejoicing. Moving through a long columned hall adorned with wall carvings of the king and queen, she came to the chamber known as Gem Bastet, the finding of Bastet. A long, narrow court stretched ahead of her, crowned by an altar atop a flight of steps. Beyond the altar, a causeway ran toward yet another pair of lofty columns. Kahent passed through them into a second court, then into a third, and finally into the smallest sanctuary. By reading her dress and jewels, the temple priests and priestesses allowed her to pass, correctly intuiting that the offering in the bag at her waist would permit entry into the holiest of holies. The floor rose at a gentle angle under Kahent's feet as the roof gradually lowered, and soon her steps brought her to the innermost sanctuary. The goddess sat on a platform behind the altar. Her priestesses hovered near with towels and basins of water to wash and dress Bastet for the day. A pile of discarded nightclothes lay in a heap on the floor, while another slave stood nearby with a platter of fruit and meat for the goddess's breakfast. Kahent fell to her knees and bent her head to the floor three times. She was as devout in her practice of religion as Donkor was indifferent in his. Yet still the goddess had blessed them. Kahent and her husband and daughter were strong and not afflicted with many of the diseases that struck less wealthy people. In gratitude and reverence, Kahent remained on the floor. She would wait until after the goddess had breakfasted, then present her petition. The priestesses adorned the goddess with robes and jewels, then placed the food on the altar. Her attendants waited in silence as the tall statue stared down on the platter, her emerald eyes twinkling in the shafting rays of sunlight from the high, clear-story windows. After several moments, at a signal from a shaven-headed priestess, One slave whisked the food away. Another clothed the goddess in a fresh collar, and a priest solemnly announced that Bastet was ready to receive visitors and deliver oracles. Kahent was the only petitioner in the sanctuary. She took a deep breath and clasped her hands to her breast.
"Oh, most divine Bastet," she began, rising to her knees before the imposing statue. "Behold your servant, who came into being from your goodness. I have a daughter of marriageable age who needs a worthy husband."
Her words echoed in the stillness of the chamber, yet nothing moved. Kahent waited, breathing in the bittersweet aromas of the burning incense, the tiled floor hard under her knees. The few priests who moved in the shadows beyond the goddess paid her no heed. No answer came to her. Nothing at all. She shifted uneasily, not sure how to proceed. Then a flat, inflectionless voice cut through the silence.
"Bastet will hear you."
A young, thin woman stepped out of the shadows, the pale skin of her shaved head gleaming in the torchlight.
"The majesty of Bastet says to you, listen to this, my servant Ramla, who will work my magic. Tell her what you will, and she will relay my divine message."
Kahent studied the girl. Tall and slender, she wore the simple white robe of a priestess and a golden collar about her neck, a symbol of the goddess's ownership. The girl could have been anywhere from 15 to 30, so unlined was her sculpted face. Kahent made a mental note of approval, but as her eyes traveled downward, one sight gave her pause. The girl's right hand was malformed. Only three fingers grew where five should have been. How could this be? Most malformed children were thrown to the crocodiles of the Nile.
"Do not let the sight of my servant disturb you."
The priestess's eyes hardened, and Kahent knew the girl had seen the revulsion in her glance.
"She has been given graces and power to atone for her physical losses. Ramla will serve you well."
With these words, the slender girl bent at the waist and bowed before Kahent.
"So be it,"
Kahent said, frowning. She paused, then dropped the bag of silver at the girl's feet.
"My petition is a matter of the heart. My daughter, who must marry well, has spent nearly every day of her life with a slave who surpasses her in beauty. I want to rid my daughter of this girl, but do not know how to proceed without arousing her to anger or breaking her heart."
Straightening into the ramrod posture of a royal guard, the priestess closed her eyes and tilted her head as if she were listening to a far-off voice. After a moment, her face cracked into a smile, and she nodded drowsily.
"Yes, Bastet,"
she murmured, opening her eyes. She shared the smile with Kahent.
"Love cannot easily be killed, but it can be distracted."
Casually, she tossed the bag of silver onto the altar, then walked to Kahent's side and took the lady's arm, lifting her to her feet.
"Take me to your home, lady, and give me a day with your daughter. Bastet has directed me to make the proper spells and incantations. I can divine the future and will not leave your daughter's side until all be well."
Stunned by the magnanimous gesture, Kahent allowed Ramla to lead her from the sanctuary.
"You sent for me, mother?"
Sagira called, rushing into the reception room. She was about to complain about the interruption of her playtime, but the sight of the stranger with her mother left her speechless. The young woman who sat in one of the gilded chairs wore the shaved head and golden collar of a priestess from one of the temples.
"Sagira, this is Ramla."
Her mother gestured to the visitor with a graceful hand.
She is a priestess at the Temple of Bastet. Feeling awkward and gauche, Sagira barely managed to nod. Ramla gave Sagira a warm smile. I do not live at the temple all the time, only 1 month out of 4. Tomorrow I begin my time of absence, and your gracious mother has said I may spend 3 months as part of your household.
We need the blessings of the goddess,
Sagira's mother said, studying Sagira with careful eyes.
Don't you agree, my daughter?
Yes.
Sagira managed a crooked smile. For what reason did they need the special favor of the gods?
I am especially looking forward to getting to know you,
Ramla said, rising from her chair. In that moment, Sagira saw the woman's misshapen hand and knew from her mother's disapproving gasp that she had not managed to disguise her horror. But Ramla did not seem to care.
Pay no attention to things that can be observed with the eyes, she said,
reaching for Sagira's hand with her whole one.
I can teach you how to discern with your heart. The gods have compensated for my missing fingers with other gifts, and I can teach you secrets you have never known. I can read the future for you, child.
Truly?
Fear fell from Sagira like a discarded cloak, and wonder slipped into its place.
Yes.
Ramla's voice was low and soothing, and her hand slipped up to stroke Sagira's hair.
Kneel before me while I work a spell of divination.
Sagira caught her breath as she fell to her knees. Her mother had often participated in such religious rituals, but until now, Sagira had been considered too much a child to have a priestess divine her future. That her mother would now allow such a practice spoke more of Sagira's maturity than the flowering of her red moon. As Sagira's mother stood to fetch the family's divining bowl, Sagira smoothed her face and tried to copy the look of earnest interest her mother wore. A moment later, Lady Kahent returned with the bowl of blackened silver. The bottom of the inner bowl had been engraved with the figure of the jackal-headed Anubis, the opener of roads for the dead. Ramla accepted the bowl and placed it on a stand, then filled it with water from a pitcher. Murmuring prayers and incantations, she poured a small amount of fine oil into the bowl from a clay vial. As the oil swirled and eddied over the surface of the water, Ramla closed her eyes and lifted her hands.
Hail to you, O Re Harakte, father of the gods. Hail to you, O ye seven Hathors, who are adorned with strings of red thread. Hail to you, Anubis, lord of heaven and earth. Cause Bastet to appear before me like an ox after grass, like a mother after her children. Send her to me so I may ask the future of Sagira, born of Donkor and Kahent.
The sweet incense in the room seemed overpowering, and a cold lump grew in Sagira's stomach as she studied the priestess. Beads of perspiration appeared at the woman's temple. Her features twisted into a maddening grimace. Tendrils of apprehension wound through Sagira's body as the priestess opened her black eyes and seemed to stare straight through flesh. Strange words flew from the seer's mouth, and her gaze darted to the bowl where oil swirled on the waters.
I see, Sagira, that you are surrounded by people who love you,
Ramla said in an awed, husky whisper. A slight smile twisted one corner of her face.
You are much loved. You will marry a man of great importance according to your parents' wishes, and Pharaoh will pronounce his blessing on the union.
Children, Lady Kahent called from a corner of the room. Will she have children?
Pearls of perspiration shone on the young woman's forehead.
You will be remembered through all time. The priestess droned, her eyes as dark as a cavern. As long as men walk on earth, they will speak of you. Your memory will be immortal.
Sagira couldn't believe what she was hearing.
Me?
Ramla trembled, then her hands flew to the sides of the bowl as she steadied herself.
Not your name, she whispered hoarsely. Your role. You will leave an imprint on the sands of time that cannot be erased.
At these words, the seer's eyes rolled up into her head, and she slumped to the floor, her limbs thrashing in a seizure. Sagira scrambled backward and shrieked, but Kahent flew to Ramla's side and held the woman's flailing arms.
For you, she has borne this,
she said, looking at her daughter with something like awe in her eyes.
You will be remembered, daughter, longer than Pharaoh, for more years than those who built the ancient pyramids.
Sagira placed her hand over her mouth and tried to stop crying. The body of the priestess stilled, but the young woman did not move. Kahent left Ramla on the floor and reached for her daughter.
My little one, she crooned,
enfolding Sagira in an embrace.
How often did I dream that you would bring glory to this house, and now I find that your glory will eclipse that of all other women.
She didn't say that,
Sagira mumbled, her mind whirling with confusion.
She said I would be remembered, and not my name but my role.
She raised her head to look at her mother.
What can that mean?
Kahent pressed her lips together and helped Sagira rise from the floor.
She said nothing as she led her daughter to the couch.
Then she motioned for Sagira to sit beside her.
It can mean only one thing, she whispered,
a smile dimpling her cheek.
And you must never speak of this to anyone, for to do so would be treason.
Sagira felt a shiver pass down her spine.
Treason?
Yes.
Kahent pressed her finger to her lips as she thoughtfully weighed her words.
As you know, daughter, the royal blood of the two kingdoms passes down from woman to woman. Amenhotep, my brother, is pharaoh because he married the heiress Merit-Amen, the daughter of Thutmosis.
But you are also a daughter of Thutmosis,
Sagira pointed out.
My mother was a lesser wife.
So what does this have to do with me?
I am also a daughter of Thutmosis,
Kahent answered, her voice a thin whisper in the room.
If the gods will that Pharaoh's house, all his sons and daughters, should be destroyed, I will be the heiress, and when I die, you will be the heiress. Whomever you marry will be pharaoh, and your sons and daughters will continue the dynasty.
As the words swirled around Sagira, she clutched the arm of her chair, stunned by the revelation.
Your role,
Kahent whispered, the breath from her lips stirring the hair at Sagira's ear.
Is obvious. You will be the mother of pharaohs, the mother of a new dynasty, the greatest in all Egypt. You and your children will leave an imprint on the sands of time that cannot be erased.
Kahent's head fell on her daughter's shoulder in a bout of joyous weeping, but Sagira sat still, thinking. She had been relieved enough to hear that she would marry well. This prophecy of immortal influence was too much to comprehend. Tuya noticed a difference in her mistress almost immediately. In the days following Sagira's introduction to the strange priestess of Bastet, she seemed withdrawn and tense, but she would not give an explanation for her altered mood. In the mornings, as Tuya arranged her mistress's toilet, Sagira was snappish and irritable, quick to complain about Tuya's heavy hand or chattering tongue. The long hours of play in the courtyard disappeared as Sagira spent time alone with Ramla. Once, when Tuya casually asked what Ramla and Sagira talked about, her young mistress turned on her and said that if Tuya didn't mind her manners, she'd have Tanutamon administer yet another whipping. 2 weeks after Ramla had come to live in the household, Tuya made her way to the kitchen. Taharka, the chief butler, had always been a friend and used to give both girls sweet treats from his lunchbox whenever they managed to sneak into his workroom. On this day, he was tasting a new wine especially selected for a party Doncor intended to give for several noble guests, and he had little time to spare for a lonely slave girl abandoned by her mistress.
Taharka, can I speak with you?
Not now, my pretty one,
Taharka said, frowning as he looked at her sad face.
The master has invited guests to eat, drink, and be merry through the night. Spiced wine and beer. The wine jars and even the alabaster vases have to be made ready.
Can I help? Taharka smiled as though out of pity for her.
You are bored, aren't you?
I'd love to help. Surely there is something I can do.
All right, you can see to the perfumed cones. The animal fat must be set out into the sun to liquefy, then mixed with the precious oils of perfume. When they are mixed, bring them into the coolness of the house and pour the liquid into the molds.
I can do that, Tuya replied, moving toward the large copper pots of animal fat. The cones of perfumed fat were a treat enjoyed only by the nobility, for perfume was precious. As each guest arrived, a perfumed cone would be placed on his head. As the afternoon and party wore on, the cones would melt and run down the heavy wigs and sweltering skin of the overheated guests. Tuya lifted one of the pots and staggered toward the doorway, but halted when Taharka let out an ear-splitting scream. She dropped the pot, startled and whirled to see him standing at a table, his hand purpling before her eyes. A scorpion scuttled across the table.
I am bit,
the butler screamed, his eyes wide in fright and pain.
Oh, daughter of Seth, why am I bit tonight?
Obeying a primitive instinct, Tuya scooped up a handful of ashes from the fire pit, mixed them with animal fat, and placed the mixture over the rapidly swelling spot on Taharka's hand. Stunned by the pain, the butler leaned against the wall, still holding his wounded hand out in front of him. As if in response to his call, Ramla and Sagira appeared in the doorway.
What happened to Taharka?
Sagira snapped, her eyes drilling into Tuya as if she were somehow to blame. Tuya lowered her gaze.
A scorpion.
Ramla stepped into the room and dramatically lifted her hands.
I am a priestess of Bastet, and have come to lay bare the poison that is in the limbs of Taharka, Donkor's servant.
As Bastet lives, so shall live Taharka.
Taharka clenched his jaw against the pain as Ramla swayed in front of him.
You, poison, shall not take your stand in his forehead. Hekayit, lady of the forehead, is against you. You shall not take your stand in his eyes. Horus Mekhenti Irti, lord of the eyes, is against you. You shall not take your stand in his ears. Geb, lord of the ears, against you.
Tuya watched Sagira's face as Ramla continued the roll call of the various gods. Her mistress's eyes shone toward the interloper with devotion and admiration.
You shall not take your stand in his nose. Kenemchu of Hezret, lady of the nose, is against you. You shall not take your stand in his lips. Anubis, lord of the lips, is against you. You shall not take your stand in his tongue. Sefekawi, lady of the tongue, is against you. You shall not take your stand in his neck.
Wadeti, Lady of the Neck, is against you. Taharka groaned as Ramla called out for the gods of the arm, back, side, liver, lung, spleen, intestines, ribs, and flesh to stand against the scorpion bite. A crowd of servants gathered as the priestess continued to chant, calling on the gods of the buttocks, perineum, thighs, knee, shins, soles, and toenails. Finally, as sweat dripped from her brows, Ramla raised her voice in a terrible shriek.
You, poison, shall not take your stand anywhere in him. You shall not find refreshment there. Go down to the ground. I have incanted against you. I have spat on you. I have drunk you. As Horus lives, so does Taharka. Go down to the ground. I know you. I know your name. Come from the right hand, poison. Come from the left hand. Come in saliva. Come in vomit. Come in urine. Come hither at my utterance according as I say. Grant a path to Taharka, as the sun shall rise, and as the Nile shall flow, so shall Taharka be better than he was.
She ended in a hoarse shout and flung her arms toward the heavens. As if on cue, Taharka leaned sideways and vomited onto the packed earthen floor. Tuya lifted the poultice she had used to cover the scorpion bite. The wound was still red and slightly swollen, but seemed less violent than it had before. The assembled crowd cheered Ramla, and Sagira slipped her arm around the priestess's waist and helped the exhausted woman from the room. Two slaves from the kitchen helped Taharka to his feet, and after a moment, Tuya found herself in the workroom with only a handful of servants, while guests were arriving at the entryway.
Hurry, she commanded, gesturing toward the pots of animal fat and the trays of fruit. The party begins, and our master will not care that Taharka has met with a scorpion. This food must be ready, so help me.
Knowing that Tanutaman's lash awaited anyone who displeased Donkor, the slaves did as she commanded. Kahent sighed in satisfaction as her slave poured a pitcher of cool water over her tired back. She lay on a slab of polished granite in the bathroom of the house, and her maid had just massaged the worries of a hectic week into oblivion. Not that her worries were major ones. In the 3 weeks since the priestess Ramla had come to dwell with them, Sagira had spent less and less time with Tuya. It would not be difficult now to manufacture an excuse to remove the girl from Sagira's quarters. And when Sagira had been weaned from her dependence on the slave, the serious search for a husband could begin.
Excuse the interruption, my lady.
Another of the maids appeared in the doorway.
Your daughter and Ramla wait to see you.
I'll see them at once. Kahent said, sitting up. Her handmaid threw a light gown over Kahent's upraised arms. She stood and shimmied into it, then went with open arms to embrace her daughter.
Sagira, what brings you to me in the middle of the day?
She asked, resting her hands on her daughter's shoulders as she kissed the girl's cheeks. Behind Sagira, Ramla stood in practiced detachment, her arms crossed, her gaze fixed on Kahent's face.
I've been thinking,
Sagira's lower lip edged forward in a pout.
If I am truly to be the mother of kings, perhaps it is best if I am not attended by such a familiar slave. Tuya knows too much about me to be properly respectful. Ramla has suggested that I send her away.
Kahent blinked in honest surprise. She had not dared to dream that Ramla's influence would work so quickly.
You would be rid of Tuya?
Sagira crossed her arms.
She is jealous and spiteful, and I don't trust her. For months she's been looking at me with a strange gleam in her eye. I don't like it. She frightens me.
Perhaps one of the dark gods has invaded her heart,
Ramla suggested in a cool voice.
Exactly!
Sagira slammed a clenched fist into her palm.
That's what I'm afraid of, Mother. You gave her to me, but now I'd like to be rid of her.
Kahent gave her daughter an innocent smile.
Perhaps she could work with the butler. Taharka seems to think much of her.
No, Sagira snapped. I will not have her anywhere near. I want her out of the house as soon as possible. She does not understand my destiny. She sees herself as my equal, and that can never be.
Joy flooded Kahent's heart.
As you say, Sagira, she said,
placing her hands on her daughter's shoulders again.
And because she is yours, whatever silver comes from her sale shall go to you.
I shall give it all to Ramla as an offering for the goddess.
Sagira turned to the priestess.
Without her, I would never have learned of my future.
Ramla leaned forward in a gentle bow.
Thank the goddess we discovered it.
Kahent closed her eyes in relief.
Bastet be praised.
The sunbark of the god Ray had moved only a short distance across the sky when Ramla came alone into the women's room of the villa. Surprised by the visit, Kahent put aside the scroll she had been reading and waited for the priestess to speak.
Your daughter is resting,
Ramla announced, gazing at Kahent with dark eyes that seemed to probe the recesses of her soul.
And your petition has been heard.
I trust it has. Kahent straightened on the couch where she had been reclining.
I owe you a great debt. Your daughter's offering will suffice,
Ramla answered.
That and the opportunity to watch the future unfold. I did not fabricate or elaborate on my vision, Lady Kahent. Sagira will leave a mark on the world.
When she hesitated, Kahent toyed with the fabric of her dress, dimly aware that she was fidgeting. What was she supposed to do now? Did the priestess expect special favors in return for good news?
Please sit,
Kahent gestured to an empty chair. Ramla moved to the chair and sat down without breaking the straight line of her back.
You and Sagira have become friends,
Kahent said, casting about for some avenue of conversation.
I am sorry you must leave soon. I fear Sagira will be lost without your company, or Tuya's.
She will never be lost, the priestess answered. We have already made arrangements. I will serve my month for the goddess, then live with your daughter for 3 months.
Her pale lips curved into a mirthless smile.
I have become your daughter's spiritual counselor. She has decided that we shall remain together.
Kahent forced a laugh.
You want to remain with Sagira? But she is a child while you are a mature woman. Surely there are others who will value your unique gifts.
A dark brow shot up, creating a startlingly oblique line across the young woman's face.
May I speak frankly?
Please do.
The corner of the priestess's mouth dipped slightly.
I am old enough, lady, to know where favor and fortune lie. A woman cannot find them within the temples of Egypt's gods.
She shrugged.
But I know Sagira's future, and I know she will need a friend. You asked me to pull her away from the slave girl, but your daughter is weak. She cannot stand alone. She needs love and a companion. She has found both in me.
I am grateful, of course,
Kahent answered, her stomach tightening at the thought of having the strange priestess in her home for 9 months of the year.
You know Sagira will be married soon.
I will go to the house of her husband,
Ramla answered, tilting her head.
You should be grateful for my help, Lady Kahent. Without my special gift, you would never have known of the god's plan for Sagira's future. Her lips curved in a half smile. But you will not want Pharaoh to know of these things.
Of course not, Kahent snapped. She could feel sweat beading under her heavy wig. It was treason even to think of taking the throne from the one who ruled as the incarnate god. If Pharaoh heard that those in Donkor's house were grooming themselves to become the next rulers of Egypt...
Do not fear, lady, Ramla said, a sweet ripple in her voice. As long as I am your daughter's spiritual counselor, I will say nothing of her destiny. With the patience of the gods, I will wait for her son to rise.
Kahent recognized the implied threat in the words.
Then I, she answered, will wait with you.
She pressed her finger to her lips as the priestess rose and left the room. Taharka rolled a heavy barrel into his workroom, his short graying hair gleaming silver in the slanting rays of the open window. He saw Tuya and frowned.
Why, my pretty one, are you alone so often these days?
Tuya kicked a shard of broken pottery out of her way.
Sagira is busy, she muttered, not looking up. She's with Ramla. She talks to that priestess for hours, and she's made it clear I am not supposed to overhear their conversations.
A passing fancy, nothing more,
Taharka promised, standing the barrel upright.
Don't you remember the time you and Sagira swore you would eat nothing but pigeon? You drove me crazy with your quirks, and Lady Kahent nearly went out of her mind with worry for Sagira's health.
Tuya laughed. I had forgotten. But this is different, Taharka. Sagira's changed somehow. She's not playing a game. In fact, I've never seen her so serious. Sometimes I think she went to sleep and a stranger woke up in her body.
Tuya!
A hoarse voice bellowed through the kitchen, and Tuya wiped her hands across her skirt as the master of the slaves stalked into the room. As broad as he was tall, Tanutaman was a man to be feared, especially when ill winds blew through Donkor's household. He never called for Tuya unless the Lady Kahent had commanded that she be whipped. Despite the chilly dew forming on her skin, Tuya stepped forward to meet him. She dipped her head toward him in submission.
What is it, master?
Tanutaman gestured toward the door.
Come with me.
What had she done? Tuya threw a questioning glance toward Taharka, but he waved her through the doorway with a hurried gesture that said, Go, and don't ask questions. Tuya followed the master of the slaves through the winding halls until they reached the gatekeeper's lodge at the entrance to the villa. The gatekeeper rose from his stool as Tanutaman approached, then backed away. Tuya held her breath, dreading whatever was to follow. There was no whipping post in the lodge, so what new punishment was this? In answer, Tanutaman pulled a length of chain and four shackles from a corner of the gatehouse.
Your hands,
he said, his voice strangely flat. Bracing herself for an assault, Tuya lifted her trembling arms. Had Lady Kahent heard about the cup of wine she accidentally spilled in Taharka's workroom? Had Lady Sagira complained about Tuya's sad countenance? Tanutaman's rough hands caught hers. With a deft gesture, he snapped the shackles on her wrists, then secured them by running a length of chain through the loops. Am I to be whipped? Tuya whispered, afraid to lift her voice.
What has the mistress said, Tanutaman?
The giant did not answer, but knelt to clasp the other pair of shackles around her legs. The cold metal chilled her skin and pressured the fragile bones in her ankles as he threaded chain through the loops.
Tanutaman,
she asked again, dismayed at the sound of tears in her voice. If I have done nothing wrong, what is this? And if I have done something, tell me what it is so I may avoid trouble in the future.
You have done nothing,
the master of the slaves answered gruffly.
Your mistress wishes to sell you. It is her right and her request.
Lady Kahent?
The young Lady Sagira.
For a moment, the words did not register in Tuya's mind. She had been a part of Doncor's family since her childhood. She and Sagira had bounced on Lady Kahent's knee, eaten their meals together, splashed in the same pool, shared gossip and dreams. It should have been easier to stop the yearly inundation of the Nile than to separate her from this family. Yet, heavy shackles bound her wrists and ankles. And even now, Tanutaman was adjusting the length of chain so he could lead her through the gate. Where are you taking me? She cried, the world blurring as tears distorted her vision. What happens when a slave is sold? I'm sorry, Tanutaman, but I know nothing of these things.
You must trust me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.